Now, in the last class, I was discussing about problem statement for verifications, and there we also discussed, right, that it is one-to-one matching and different types of errors, and also we told the types of database. One is a centralized database and another one is the distributed database, and where we are using the centralized database and where we should use the distributed database. The distributed database will be useful when you are handling or locally some information. Say for example, I want to make the attendance only for this room, and I do not care whether you are attending the other buildings class or not. So, then it will be sufficient for me that in your card, you come with your smart card where we put the attendance history or biometrics information, right, because nowadays cards are having huge amount of space. So, you can give your biometric data and take that information from your smart card, we match it and we take the decision and mark on your card itself. So, whenever you surrender your card, we can always find out the history, how many days you are present, which are the days you are absent, right, and so on. Assumption is that most of the, see, I have 41 lectures or 42 lectures or 10 lectures, 30 lectures, some number of lectures are there, and the day, and I know the my lecture periods, say only Monday, Thursday. Monday, Thursday means 1 and 4. So, 1, 4, 1, 4, 1, 4, 1, 4 will be written, right? And the day you are absent, that day it will be marked 0, otherwise it will be marked 1. So, it is not a very big 41 bits I need, 41 bits I need just to mark whether you are present or absent. So, space wise is not a very big space, and also that you will be storing the feature vectors. Now, feature vectors also I told you that for fingerprints, say I am keeping the Manisha points, and Manisha points is generally we expect 30 to 40 Manisha points, and each is giving you the coordinates x, y, theta and the type of Manisha points. So, that means 4 bytes you need, 4 bytes into 35, so 140 bytes you need, right, to represent your fingerprints things. Now, you with the assumption that I am once I am using the bytes, the precision is an important thing. So, you may not get enough precision. Now, if I assume that no, sir, I want to put real numbers, then 140 into 4, those numbers will be coming, those many bytes will be there. What do you need? You need the machine must be able to, that system where you will be swiping your card must be able to extract the features and must be able to match. So, that is the additional things which is not available on your smart card or on your fingerprint. So, that is additional part. In the case of centralized one, the idea is that whether I am eligible to be a member to get a card, or if we assume that you should get only one card, right, all people are not eligible to enter into this room or enter into the academic area. So, only some varied people are eligible to enter into. So, I need a centralized information, and for that only centralized database is coming in between. Also, centralized database will keep information about the multiple, say for example, fingerprint is the issue, multiple fingerprints. Suppose one finger due to some reasons is missing, or some problem have occurred. So, the finger quality is not coming good, then you must be able to get the other fingers information on your smart card, right. So, you can tell that yes, this finger is not giving me the good results. So, system will change your smart cut based on your next best quality images, right. Say sometimes you keep iris, say iris data. Now, I have the left eye and right eye. So, on your card will give you the left eye say, but after time t, I may give you the right eye. So, you have an opportunity. So, those information should be kept in your central database. Say in the case of Aadhaar card, what it has been decided? That in central database you have the enough number of or all sorts of 10 fingers data will be there, your iris will be there, your face, everything is there. But in reality, it will be using, it will use your only one finger or two fingers, right, based on the need, right. But while I will be going for another card, at that time all your data, that fingerprint, iris, all those information will be taken into account to see whether you have already gotten a card or not, because it has been decided that one person should get only one card, right. In the case of identification, it is coming with a different problem. It is 1 to n match. That means that if you get some information, biometric information, you have to find out whether similar or almost same biometric feature based human being exists in the database or not. If exists, then you have to return those people, because since you are may not get, because you know today you give your biometric data and afternoon if you give your biometric data or tomorrow you give your biometric data, thereof you will need not be the exactly you will get the same data, right, because you will be looking for the features, features will be translated, rotated, or noise will be there, all sorts of problem will be there. So, you will not get exactly, you should not get exactly same features. Some feature may be there, some feature may not be there, right. So, you will be getting a list of people, and this list of people will be useful to identify based on other characteristics. So, that is the idea. So, it will be giving you the n best matches, and suppose nothing is available, no match is available, that means you are a new person. So, your biometric data should be entered into my database, right, to make it a closed environment. So, it is expected that once I am developing a biometrics identification system, I should allow to use my database, right, whatever, otherwise it will be difficult. So, whoever develops the identification system, she should be able to access the whole database, and the idea is that your matching algorithm should be able to match the your query template along with the all the templates of your database, right. So, output, as I told you, it will give you the list of subjects which are similar or almost resemble with the input biometrics data. Now, there are two terms I will be using, one is known as positive identification, another one is positive negative identifications. Positive identification means it determines all the list of people who are having this list of people available in the database who are having the similar features of query image, right. So, obviously, there will be two types of error here, one is false acceptance rate, another one will be false rejection rate. So, to measure the performance of your biometrics identification system for positive identifications, you will be using mainly the two types of error, one is FAR and another one is FRR. Negative identification means that it determines that a given individual is not in my database, right. That means here database is closed with respect to the negative people, not with respect to the genuine people. The other one here, database is closed with respect to everybody, right. Here I create a database whom I don't want that to enter in my complex, right? And given a biometric data, I will check whether he is among of those people who are not supposed to enter in my complex, right? So there will be two types of error here. One is known as false negative. False negative means that he was supposed to be in that negative list. He was not supposed to be allowed to enter into my complex, but due to some reasons he is through, he has been allowed to enter. That is the false negative. And false positive, a genuine person has been considered as he should not be allowed, right? So this false negative is similar to false accept, and false rejection is similar to false positive, right? Now the question is coming that how to create the database means enrollment stage. You have the, what are the things you have? You have a person and or individual, and you have certain credential, right? Certain certificates, or maybe I can tell what is your name, what is your father's name, what is your date of birth, what is your qualification, or what is your income. Those proofs you need. And subject has come in front of the sensor, sensor gives, they accept the data, and once accept the data, it extracts the features. And we also discussed this issue earlier that while accepting the features, he has to do several operations. He has to see the whether quality is image, quality of the image is good or not. If the quality is not good, he will be asking again and again to give his data so that sensor accepts the data with certain quality. And then only feature extractor extract the features. Credential, you the data will be matched, because there may be requirement that I want that all those people whose income is less than what, 1 lakh rupees per annum. So he needs to prove, or special category people I want, so that he needs certain info, he has to provide certain information, and you have to check it. Yes, it is matched, so data has been matched. Using these two, it creates a template, right? So one thing you remember, currently what we are doing is that I assume the demographic data or the credential data is different from the biometric data. They are two different entities. You come and you, based on your credential and also biometric, I could have checked it. But generally, once I get a card, I will give only biometric data. Why shall I show my credential every time, right? So, but template will be kept made in such a way that it takes both the things and kept ready, because if required, we can suppose my biometric data is not matching, I could have told you, okay, show me now, since it is not matching, give me some other information, tell me your phone number or tell me your something, so that it is matching or not, that can be thought, right? And based on that, you can generate your ID. So the positive enrollment and negative enrollment, because you have the two things, one is positive database, another one is negative database. So in the positive enrollment, what it means that this will be useful for verification and positive identifications. So here you will be entering all the data who are eligible in your database. Now the definition of eligible is my criteria. That criteria is what? That if your income is less than this, or if you are below poverty level, or if you are some criteria you have, right? You must be, or if you are a citizen of India, or some criteria if you prove, if you put, then only you are eligible. So you will be coming, the subject will come with those informations in front of you, somebody will verify, and if he satisfies the requirement, then only you will be allowed to provide your biometrics data, right? And once you put the data, then it will be in the form of templates, and you will be getting the ID for that purpose. In the case of negative, it is completely different, negative enrollment. Here, first thing is that It is used for negative identifications. And in the database, whom you are keeping? Those who are not eligible, right? Is a those who are not eligible to enter into my complex. Their data will be there. Now, how can you tell that I am not eligible? Because you know it is a very sensitive one. If I tell you that don't enter into this my complex, you are not eligible, right? Right? You will feel bad. Everybody will feel bad. Everybody has certain sense of, right? Sense of whether I should be honored or not. Suppose you tell no, you are not eligible to my complex. It will, you have to justify why you are not allowing him. So that is, you have to find out what credential, negative credential he has, so that you are not allowing him, right? Suppose in my complex I don't want to allow those who takes gutka. Nowadays that tradition is going, gutka will not be allowed. So gutka people I will not allow. Also I am telling that okay, those who are having the habit of stealing something, right? These people are also, there will be, you know, different types of people. So but a person who takes gutka, he may not be a thief, right? So you have to write down specifically that this person I will not allow who, because he takes gutka, this person I will not allow because it is a thief, and this person I will not allow because he is satisfying by both criteria. All those credentials must be written carefully. Now once you come, now there is a possibility that you are taking gutka, but your system database does not contain your name, because you have fixed this people name only. You will be allowed to enter into the system, right? So that is basically those issues should be clearly, because you can tell that yes, you are allowing him, but you are not allowing me, satisfying both the criteria, right? He is also taking gutka, I am also taking gutka, but you are allowing him, but you are not allowing me. This is not a correct thing, right? So those things should be pinpointed so that you don't face problem. Now one thing is that this data will be involuntary. Nobody will come forward to tell you that I take gutka, so don't allow me to enter, right? It is the authority who has to decide who are not allowed and who will be allowed. And so it, you have to take this information under covert operation. It is a covert fashion. Covert fashion means that he should not know. He should not know, because otherwise it may dishearten, it may create problems and so on. So you may not get, because cooperation from the concerned person, even if you ask that okay, I am not allowing you, but you have to give your biometric data, then he will not come forward, right? He does not want that my name should be or his name should be in the list. So what you are thinking, that I cannot think where his fingerprint is required. He will not give you the fingerprint. Once he comes to know that if I give my finger his fingerprint, then he will be barred from entering into the list. So face may be one possible solution, where you take hiddenly his photograph and enter into the system. This I have covered. Now the biometric system security. What does it mean, security? You know, say what does it mean that my room is secured? Can you tell me that room is secured? Enough? Necessary intervention must not be there. Suppose one way is that you can lock the room, right? So room is secure. Does it secure? It is secure with respect to thief, right? But it is not secure with respect to fire. So you have to define carefully what is security, right? Now the thing is that security is the safety of the application, whatever application it is, you want to make it safe. So, what is that? It can be achieved by whom? By the eliminating the vulnerabilities as point of attacks on assets of the application. So, you have certain assets of the applications and every asset has certain vulnerabilities, right? For this room, maybe that projector has some vulnerabilities. So, you have to think that there exists certain point of attack, those should be eliminated. That is the important thing. So, in the financial application, the asset is money. Of course, this is the, I should save my money. That is the in case of financial application. In my travel application, you must ensure the traveler is safe, or the transportation you are using, that is safe, right? So, so this asset word is variable. It depends upon the environment where you are using. So, secure my asset is safe, what is the type of asset? Based on that, you will be deciding what type of security is required. Now, in the case of biometric system, the vulnerability is the impersonation, because biometrics is also a system, is also an asset. So, it is vulnerability with respect to the impersonation. Now, what does it mean that impersonation? You know, it goes worst when you know somebody wants to make use of your biometric system or wants to use your system even without your presence, right? That is the, up to that level you can think. One is that I can force you to give your biometric information, sign on this paper forcibly, and then I withdraw the money or whatever I do. This is possible. Another one is that I am not there and you have withdrawn my money. So, that is the level. So, it can range from the latent fingerprint, right, from the objects. Say, what happens on your, suppose you take a glass of water, right, and after taking the water, your fingerprint will be there. That is known as latent fingerprint, and from there also I can determine your fingerprints. Right, then I can have a mask on it, and then I can prepare a plastic cover or using your mask, and I can put on my finger and I can make use of it. So, the latent fingerprint from objects to the violent acts like cutting the fingers and so on. So, by cutting the finger, I'll tell my fingerprint is not, my finger is not correct or it is not, it is a affected one, so I cannot provide you the data. So, I will give other information and give my money. So, all those issues are there. Now, think about this latent fingerprints. Does it not similar to your password stolen? Say, for example, the in the latent fingerprint, what happens? That I will lift your fingerprints from the objects where you have given your fingerprints. Then what I will do? I will take the photograph of that fingerprints, right, and then process it. Then I will prepare one mask on it and I will put those information on that mask and then I will cover it and I will, can withdraw your money, provided that the sensor does not have the concept of dead finger or live finger. So, what happens that you have given unknowingly your fingerprints on some objects and that has been used. Similarly, that password is also same thing, right? Knowingly or unknowingly, somebody has come to know your password and he can make use. So, the problem is same. Only thing is the degree of difficulty is different. That knowing password is a 4-digit number. And I know that your behavior, your different knowledge, based on that, I can determine what is your password. But this is not the case with the fingerprints. He has to put lot of efforts, right? So, degree of difficulty is different, and I will be using only this one if the value cost I need to spend to determine my fingerprint cap must be much, much less than the money I will be getting through this process, right. Otherwise, what for I will be doing all this, I will steal the biometric data, because that will not be used. I have spent huge amount of money, I have spent huge amount of time, but in return if I do not get anything, right, does not make sense. These are the different terms very frequently people will be using while we will be discussing about the biometric system, right. Say, I want to put biometric data on my server room or biometrics in entrance in server room. So, the term you will find one is that access control. It is a process to limit the people to enter into a system or right. So, this is the thing, a mechanism for limiting the use of some resources to the authorized user. Right? Access control list is the list of people who can use your system. Authenticate, this is just English word to determine something which is genuine. Authentication is the process by which you will be telling that yes, he is a genuine one and his identification has been verified and he may be allowed to use the system. And authorization is nothing but the permission to use the system. This is the commonly used thing, the secure authentication protocol. A protocol is what? An orderly sequence of steps. This is the one thing, it is not the sequence of steps, it is orderly sequence of steps that two or more parties follow to accomplish the task. Suppose you have a task that has to be solve or that has to be done by two or more parties, then you have to have certain orderly defined steps, orderly sequence steps. The order steps is very important, it must be well defined, right. Otherwise, protocol fails to regulate the behavior of the parties. So, all the parties must agree to follow the protocols. That is the first criteria. At any stage, they should not tell, I have not understood the protocols, right. Any protocol. So, this is the important properties on protocols. Say, for example, the telephonic conversation, this is a very common thing. Suppose I give a call on your mobile, what do you do? You tell hello, right. Suppose you do not tell hello. Hello is the, if you tell hello, then I tell hello, or I am Falguni speaking, something I will tell, or you will be telling your name instead of telling hello. Something is there. Once you tell hello or you tell your name or something and I listen that one, then I will tell my name, then you will accept my name, then you know match occurs, then only that you realize that two genuine parties wants to talk to each other. But if I call you and you do not speak, you are just sitting idle, then what I will do? Right? I will feel that most probably that this link has not been established. There is some problem, he is not getting my call. So, I will detach, again I will tell, till you tell hello. That is the general way, right. Now, another thing is that once I ring and I call you, what are you telling? You start telling all abusive language. Is there any possibility? You will not do, because you know what is this, right. So, that is, it does not allow the in your protocol. So, what happens? That this protocol is completely defined and designed before it is used. It is a well defined, and it is not that on the spot you define that this should be my protocol, right. It is a well defined. Say, sometimes you use code language also, but that code has to be well defined. Otherwise, the other party will not establish the link, right? It will not be possible. So, this is a well-defined proposal. And then you should have the proper workflow. Now, in the workflow, there will be certain steps to be followed. In each step, there are certain rules that should be well-defined. There should not be any ambiguity at any stage, so that you are sitting idle, right? Say, for example, if I call you and you are just sitting idle, well, there is an ambiguity that you don't know what to do. If I receive a call, what shall I do with this, right? But that should not be there. It should be well-defined one. And then there should be certain way, certain technique by which you learn, yes, these two credentials are matched, so you can, they can talk to each other, right. So this is the establishment, protocol establishment. Now, this coming that mutually agreed, that whatever workflow, whatever rules you define, all the parties must agree that yes, we will follow this. You cannot tell at any stage that no, I don't agree, I did not agree to this. Whatever you decided, you should decide a priori, and everybody has to follow accordingly. Unambiguous, that nobody should tell that I failed to do this thing because I did not understand the rules, I did not understand the protocols, right, or I did not understand the workflow. So, that is why I did not follow that one. So, that is unambiguous. Then, complete. Complete means that at any stage, what happens? There is a possibility you do not know what to do under this, what rule I will follow, right. So, that should not be there. Even there does not exist any rule, there should be an exception handling situation, which also will be well defined, that under these circumstances, these steps to be followed if you do not have any answer on this, right. You cannot just cancel the things because I did not understand. So, there are people, they do it, right. While telephonic conversation, this is an example, telephonic conversation. What happens? That you are in big problem, you just cut the, you do not want to go further, right. So, you stop it. So, but that is not a good practice, right. There are several people, you know, at the end, he forgets to tell either by or something that, okay, let me stop my discussion, let me keep it, something like that. Protocol feels that you should tell that, yes, let us stop now discussion, we will talk to you later. But there are people, they do not speak, they just switch off the or cancel the link. Now, in any system, right, it is expected that there are at least two security services, right. In access control also, it is expected there will be at least two security services. One of them is authentication, right, and the other one is non-reputation. Now, what is authentication here? That in the case of communication, it is authenticated, the communication is authenticated. What it means, suppose in the case of communication, I want to talk to another person. So, if I dial it, the other person also will give the through protocol, it will be link will be established. Yes, I will listen to him. And I will understand that he is the genuine man whom I am asking, who I am looking for. Suppose you make a call and you get a voice from somebody, you must understand, yes, he is the man whom I am talking. Otherwise, suppose I call and I am realizing I have received a response, but it does not look like that his voice it is, right. There is a possibility, sometimes it happens, right. Somebody else picks up the phone. So, you will not start telling all the history that this is the thing there. You have to ask him, that you have to understand that who is the person there. Is it the same person whom you are looking for? If only, then only tell there is a match occurred. Otherwise, you will be looking for that man. That is the standard practice. So, first part is that this, once you, this initiation, a connection initiated, then you must ensure that both the parties are genuine. Second rule is that there should not exist, that there should not be another third party who is tapping your thing, who is also listening your, or and who is also not connected in your system, right? So that is the thing, that you must ensure that there exists, there does not exist any third party who is interfering your activity. Now, the second service, what we are thinking, non-repudiation, what it means, that it prevents both the parties from denying the transmitted message. Well, that if a message is sent, then receiver must have the proof that yes, he has sent me this message, right? At the same time, if a message is received by somebody, then sender must have the proof that he has sent this and it has been received by him, right? So this is the most important service what we expect from any security system. Besides that, the confidentiality is another important thing, which anyway, because once I tell that it is secure, then it should be confidential. Now, consider an authentication system. So, there will be one device to collect the data, credentials, right? So, let us assume that you have a credential A, which gathers all your credentials and then he verifies that these credentials are correct. If required, he will be having an output device to show you that yes, this is the credential you have given, this is the quality of your credential and so on. Once you accept that yes, I agree with all of them, right, then only the system A will transfer the data to the next system, which is authentication system, right? And in the authentication system, what it does, he checks all your credentials, he accepts, determines the features, and these features will be matched with your database, and if it is matched, then he sends to the system C, who will be telling yes, you are the genuine person. So, you will be allowed to use the other whatever service you want to perform. So, this one example is that your, again, once you have gone there to other card to give your data, they have done all typing, they have taken your all demographic information, then they have shown you, right? Do you agree with all of them? Then if you tell no, I do not agree, then they will try to correct it. Again, if you that you tell no, this is not this, this is this should be this, and then they will do it, and after showing that, then they will tell okay, now agreed, then you have to press a key or you have to take a give a signature. Then only you will be allowed to go to another device for giving your biometrics information. Once it is there, then the template will be created and the next that access control things is there. Say, for example, when I am telling the demographic data, say I am from East and I have come to North India to give you my biometrics data, I face big problem. Say my name is Falguni Gupta. Now, they will always write in Hindi, Gupta, is there, but in Bengali it is Gupto, right. So, now I also do not know how to write in Hindi what is Gupto, O will be there or O will not be there, because in Bengali there is no O concept, right. If it is there, it is always there, otherwise it is not there, something like that. Same thing, if I go from North India to South India, this problem will be there, all sorts of things, and you know, and you have to, they will write in Hindi and you have to read in Hindi, I may not know Hindi, and all those issues are coming in between. Anyway, that this device plays that role. Now, by now, all this terminology you have understood, but for completeness sake, I am covering again that one is the possessions, what P is, another one is knowledge, another one is biometrics. So, PKB will be used very frequently, but most widely used is P and K, that not only position, but also your knowledge, right? And biometrics gives you additional security because it is hard to share. So, this PK is used mostly because in computer accounts, internet, email accounts, phone calls, etcetera. Now, they hear that one issue is that once you are using PK method, then first part that whatever you use, that should be exactly match. That if you use the password or knowledge, then knowledge has to be matched exactly whatever you have stored there. If you use the car key to open the door, then that key has to be matched exactly with the same composition part inside, right? Otherwise, you cannot establish the link. Now, the issue is that you have the knowledge and you have the under possession something. Based on that, you are identifying that I am the man, which is not correct. See, by showing the whatever you under your possession, by showing whatever knowledge you have, you can prove the card which contains all the informations, right? Suppose, but you cannot prove that I am the person because I have these informations. So, that is the major problem here, but it is not the case with biometrics, right? But the problem with the biometrics is something different. Here, in the case of possession and knowledge, that if I misplace my card and I forget my knowledge, then you are in problem. If somebody knows the whatever your password and somebody knows whatever is the key, he can also use your thing. But in the case of biometrics, that is not possible because it is not shareable. But issue is that biometric data will not give you exact match later on. In the case of knowledge or possession, that must be exactly matched, one to one match, then only. But in the case of biometrics, even though it is not shareable, but you will not get the exact match. So, in the case of possession, properties that can be shared, can be duplicated and may be lost or stolen. In the case of knowledge, it is easy to guess and can be shared or forgotten. And in the case of both knowledge and possession, can be shared, right? In the case of biometrics, it is not possible to share, reputation is unlikely, forging difficult and cannot be lost or stolen. This is mostly I have covered, except that biometrics can be lost only when there is a serious accident or severe illness or due to some other reasons. Now, is there any boundary between the possessions and the knowledge? That is the big problem. That which part you can tell this is under possession, which part you can tell it is under knowledge. For example, that a credit card, right? Now, in the credit, I need or ATM card, right? I need some place, I may need ATM card and also ATM card number. So, card number you have to remember, it is in the knowledge, or PIN is your knowledge, and card you have to swap the card. So, card is also has to be there, right. So, there is a difficult to tell that this is the part up to you tell that it is on possession and this is your knowledge domain, right. So, this has to be difficult, but in the case of biometrics, it is not that. It is completely separate entity. The possessions use the key of room to enter. Knowledge is the use the password, and possession knowledge is the use the ATM card, because it contains both the informations, and biometrics is the biometrics characteristics. Now, authentication rule is that you will be allowed several times, say 5 times, 6 times, after that automatically it will stop, it will not allow you to go ahead, right. Have you used the ATM card with different PIN? Have you tried without using your PIN, somebody else's PIN you use and use your card? Did you try? After 5 attempts, it blocks the card, right? And then what you do? You go to the bank, then bank will tell, come after 3 days. Then what happened? By 3 days, I cannot withdraw my money. See, nowadays it is blocking the card. Earlier days, initial while it started, so after 5 attempts, the card vanishes, card goes inside. You have to go inside to the manager to get the card back. So here, if it fails, then we expect the stop. But in the, if you see the Gmail account or Yahoo account and you give some wrong password or you have forgotten and you want to type, it gives captcha. And that captcha is such a complicated one, it is not readable, right? Sometimes they put the double captcha. Double captcha means two captcha and one on the top of another one. So, which one is coming, and they are not valid word also sometimes. If it is a valid word, you can guess, but that is not a valid word, some random characters are there. So, matching the two samples in the case of PIN, it is exactly matching, but in the case of biometrics, it is not the case, it is a pattern matching. So, pattern matching will never give you the exact solution, as I am telling you, there will be lot of noises, so you have to use the word threshold. How much or what is the percentage that it matched with the patterns, right? So, that threshold is very important parameters for biometric system, and that threshold is dependent on the sensor, it should be dependent on the atmosphere, it should be dependent on control environment, non-control environment, all those factors will be coming into the picture. So, the structure is that you have the feature extractor, subject has come, feature extractor matcher, score and the decision. That decision is the important thing now, because your matcher is what? Matcher is nothing but you will be finding some distance formula through which you will be telling how much percentage or what is the percentage matched, and that will give you the score. Now, based on the score, you have to take the decision, right? So, if the score is greater than threshold, then you tell match, otherwise you tell it does not match. Now, greater than the score means what? Greater than the score means that this is when a similarity match. If these two are similar, then 100% should be matched. If it is completely too different, then 0% match, right? In the case of dissimilarity, the symbol will be different. If S is less than T, then decision is matched, otherwise decision is matched. Now, you take the two fingerprints and both of them are having say above 30 minutia points, probability that at some of the fingerprints, some of the minutia points are matched is very high. You will get at least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, some numbers, the minutia points will be matched. You will not find a case where that these two minutia point of these two fingerprints are such that there does not exist any fingerprint minutia point which are not matched. It is not that. So, matching score will not be 0, right? Now, once you get matching score, right? So, what do you get? I will have matching score, and you have a set of people, say population size is n, and one query image has come, that query image will be matched with him and you will get one matching score. Say matching score is this, another matching score will be like this. Some matching score you will be getting, some of them will be like this, some of them here. So you can have some this type of graph, right. So this has been matched with n people, that matching scores, some people will have almost same value, some will very less people will have exact match and so on. So this is known as matching score versus frequency graph, right. Now suppose I assume, because you want to match, suppose this is the genuine person, that x is there and this is the person. So you will be putting your threshold is like this, so that you are accepting only this span, remaining will be thrown out, right. Now this threshold value cannot be different for different persons, right. See, another person is there, his graph is also like this and his threshold value is here, the genuine match. So if you consider this is my threshold value, then this man will be out. Agreed? Now suppose you consider this is the threshold value, then this is in. This man is also in, but there may be some other person here, some other people, right. Then all of them also will be in. So you are falsely accepting these people. So the selection of threshold, first part I am telling that it cannot be dynamic, it cannot be. You cannot decide for this man threshold value is this, for that man threshold value is this, that you cannot do, it is not feasible. Second part is that your threshold value cannot be, will not be such that only genuine people will be accepted, it is not possible, right. So by that process you will be accepting some people, right. And if you do not accept, suppose I consider this, then you will be rejecting this man, genuine person, which is falsely rejected. So if you see, that there is a, if you consider that different threshold and versus the matching score, now the you will be getting the different thresholds and in another side there will be a matching score. So you can obtain the matching score versus threshold graph, right, and based on that you can obtain the different types of what is the optimum value of your threshold, so that you can, you know, satisfy your requirement. Now the satisfy your requirement is the difficult, or is dependent on your application. For example, I want that any transaction in bank means that it is more than 5 crore rupees, right. So if it is more than 5 crore rupees, it is a very big number. So I will not allow any false accepted people. I do not mind to reject genuine person, because it is a money is very costly. So here constraint is that my threshold will be such that falsely accept will be 0 and whatever false rejection comes, I do not mind. The other case is that class attendance, where I do not mind if somebody wants to come and attend extra person, there is no problem. I know that people will not come to extra class, he is so selfish, he attends only his class. Right, because he needs a good grade in his class. So in that case, false acceptance is not a problem, but false rejection is the issue. So your threshold should see that constraint? What should be the approach? So, people will ask you that what is the false acceptance rate? So, once you tell your false acceptance rate is 0, corresponding false rejection rate will come out based on your threshold value, right. So, there are three parameters, one is the false rejection rate, another false acceptance rate, another threshold value. If one you define, other two automatically you can define from the graph.